But at that time, we didn't have the knowledge that we have now. And so they didn't know how to help me. They didn't know how to. The only thing we knew to do was pray. So that's what we did. We prayed. We asked God to come and bring healing into that place. And I did experience a level of freedom and healing from being able to bring it into, you know, I wasn't carrying all that shame and guilt, as at least on the level that I was before. And so that started my healing process. But let me tell you, it just kept on and on. And then later on, you know, as I entered into high school and entered into adulthood, I thought, you know, maybe the dreams would stop when I got married, and maybe, you know, when I was in a committed relationship that things would get better. But it really, I was very open with my wife when we were in our courtship, and which Holly is the only girl that I ever dated or had a last. And she's a gift to me from God. But we were very honest, and that was one of the things that I wanted her to know everything about me, and because I wanted our relationship to be, you know, completely into the light. And we made God the center of our relationship. We met at Bible college, and we were both just seeking God, and He put us together. But I shared everything with my wife, and so I would tell her, you know, I'd wake up with the dreams or, you know, different things, and confess to her when I was struggling. But still, it was just continuing. And it wasn't until we started teaching Triumph Over Trauma, and there was a select few people who I confessed to about what was going on and the ways that the enemy would attack me through dreams and different things. And so, but as we started teaching Triumph Over Trauma, and as we were in the middle of working with a whole branch full of boys that had all been sexually abused themselves, and so my stuff was in my face all the time. My abuse was in my face all the time, because here I see it played out in the boys that I'm working with. And so I really wasn't, I was crying out to God for healing, I was crying out to God. But I remember we used to use a lot of clips from a DVD series that we can, if you want to know about it, we can give you the information on it. But it's Robert Morris and who's the other?
James Robeson,
that's what it is. And it's called Living Free, Breaking the Cycles of Defeat. And at the end, they do a cleansing prayer. And I just been, we've been teaching Triumph Over Trauma, and I've been confessing and telling my testimony to people, because, you know, we know the statistics about sexual abuse. It's rampant, it's everywhere, and the church doesn't usually, it gets swept under the rug a lot and not brought into the light, and it just is those secret sins that are dirty and shameful, and we don't want to get them into the light, we don't want to talk about them, we don't want to bring it up. And ultimately, that's the very thing that is perpetuating a lot of the trauma in the church, is because we won't bring things into the light, and that's where confession is so powerful. But I remember going through, Holly and I were just kind of watching the video series and going through it, and at the end they do like a cleansing prayer, a lot like what we did yesterday morning. And I was just again asking God, I just confess, you know, I want this gone, and I'm just, you know, really pressing into God for Him to remove this. And I felt it left. I felt it leave that night. And I haven't had the dreams, I think maybe two times or three times in the last 4 years. So I've had a major release, but I think coinciding with what God did, just as I was confessing to Him and just praying and asking Him for to take it away, that I was also activating my power by confessing in front of groups of 7 to 100 people about my trauma and what had happened to me. And the shame that I carried of that, and how it affected my relationships. So confession has a very, very powerful, powerful position when we're talking about your healing.
Amen.
And so, and when it's carrying shame and guilt, that's when it's really, the enemy tells you, you know, you can't confess that. That's just. Or we tell ourselves, well, I'll just confess that to God. And that is, that is true. You confess that to God, and you are forgiven, and there you will have a level of healing. But I want to talk about a little bit more about what Jesus did to set us free, and what God's Word specifically says about confessing to one another. Let me back up just a little bit. We need to get these things that the wrongs done to us, we need to get these things in the open. We need to talk about them with trusted Christian friends or mentors or pastors. And so this isn't something that you just take nonchalantly. There are people that can't handle the pain, they can't handle that trauma, or you know, there's been situations where you know, you confess to someone and they kind of LTM, well, you think that's bad, this is what happened to me. And so you want to make sure that it's done in the right context with the right person. And if you don't have a safe person to do that with, then we encourage you to begin to pray into that, and you can also see us. We have always committed to be a safe place, that whatever is confessed to us, we do not share, we do not bring it up, we're not going to teach it in a triangle of trauma class. This is about us walking with people to see them set free. So, Isaiah 53, 4 and 5, this is talking about what Jesus has done to set us free, to bring healing. It says, surely he took upon our pain. So Jesus took the pain that the enemy is perpetuating. And Jesus took it. He bore our sufferings, our anguish, and our sorrow. And by his wounds, we are healed. By his wounds, we are healed. That word suffering in the Hebrew is makab, and it means anguish or affliction, grief, pain, and sorrow. And so anytime that we've been wrong, or we've been abused, or we've been traumatized by another individual, then we are carrying anguish, grief, and sorrow, that affliction that is on us. And many times we take on the victim stance because we were victimized. Okay? And I want to pinpoint something here. You can't choose whether or not you are victimized. But you can choose whether or not you claim being a victim.
Right.
Okay? Being a victim is a choice. Being victimized is not a choice. But wearing the label and carrying the identity of a victim is a choice. And I wanted to make that very, very clear, that as a victim myself, or being victimized, I did not want to choose to stay in the place of being a victim. Because we know that victim thinking keeps us in immature thinking and keeps us in the place of little t truths and lies, and keeps us in that immature thinking, and ultimately will lead to criminal type thinking because we view ourselves as the victim all the time. So, Jesus says, give me your pain, because he bore it. Jesus carried it. Why do you want to carry it anymore? So many times we carry this shame. We carry the pain of our abuse. And God is saying, I'm paying for this. Why are you carrying it? Why are you letting this continue to bring pain and trial and suffering into your life? And Jesus is saying, give me that pain. Give me that pain. Luke 4, 78 and 79 says, all this will flow from the kind and compassionate mercy of God. A new day is dawning. The sunrise from the heavens will break through into our darkness, and those who huddled in night, those who sit in the shadows of death, will be able to rise and walk in the light, guided in the pathway of peace. John 8, 12, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness, because you will have the light that leads to life. And that's the same life, Zoe life, that's talked about in John 10:10. So the devil deceives us and says we have to carry this pain. It's our cross to bear, and it's our shameful past. Now that is a lie, because Jesus took your cross.
That's right.
Okay? When Jesus says, take up your cross and follow me, that's not saying, hey, you need to drag a bunch of your past and your garbage with you. No, he's saying choose walking life every day, because that's what the cross paid for. We think that we have to keep it a secret. We have to keep it in the darkness. And Let me tell you these scriptures from Luke and John that talk about being in the darkness. If you have unconfessed areas of your life, scripture says that the darkness is in you when you have unconfessed things in your life. That there is darkness in you, and those things cannot be healed because they're not brought into the light. We say things like, I don't want to talk about it, or I don't talk about it, or change the subject, or I'm not going there, or we just walk away, we just won't bring it up. So the devil brings pain that has fear and grief attached to it, and we believe his lies, and then he leads us right into sin. Remember, wounds, lies, sin. Unconfessed things in our life, whether it's the wrongs done to you or the wrongs you have done, are pain that is not submitted to Jesus. And that's pain that will lead you into sin because that pain is not brought into the light where it can be dealt with, where it's not subject to the lies of the enemy anymore. Are you hearing me? Okay. The devil brings pain, fear, and grief. We believe his lies, and then he leads us right into sin. And we don't even want to look at our sin. We don't even want to call it sin. In fact, many times when we're dealing with the wrongs done to us, we're justified in our behavior because of it was done to us and we had no control over it, especially as a child. Yeah. And so we justify our behaviors, we justify our bitterness, we justify our unforgiveness, we justify our rage, we justify our bad behaviors and our habits, we justify those things because it wasn't fair and what was done to us was wrong. And those are true things. Those are true things. But we won't want to look at our sin. We don't want to call it sin. So we'll carry bitterness. We'll carry unforgiveness. We'll carry jealousy. We'll carry unbelief. We'll carry anger. And we'll justify our actions because of the wrongs done to us. We feel justified in acting the way we do because what happened to us wasn't our fault. And that's true. It wasn't your fault. But that doesn't mean that we get to use that as a license to continue in the cycle of defeat and sin. So let's deal with a little bit even harder situation. Some people have no problem confessing the wrongs done to them. In fact, they want the whole world to know, and they'll call out their abuser, and they'll point them out, and they love shouting the name of the person that hurt them because, you know, that's their way of trying to get back at the other person. That is not how we deal with confession. Okay? That is not how. That's keeping your pain fresh. That's keeping everything really good and juicy so that you can relive that and really hold on to that bitterness and that anger against the person. I mean, just make sure that you are clear that confession, that's not confession. Confession has to carry humility with it. So let's talk about confessing our sins. This is where it gets a little bit harder because there's a whole lot of fear connected to this. And the enemy loves to pack in fear in this area about confessing the wrongs that we've done. But here's the truth that Jesus says. Here's the truth out of James chapter 5. Confess to one another, therefore, your faults, your slip-ups, your false steps, your offenses, your sins, and pray also for one another that you may be healed and restored to a spiritual tone of mind. The earnest, heartfelt, continued prayer of a righteous man makes tremendous power available. Dynamic in its working. Holy Spirit power to overcome the enemy. 1 John 1:5 and 7 says, God is light. You heard Jesus just say that earlier. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him, and yet walk in darkness. These are the darkness of lies, cover-up, secrets, bitterness, jealousy, anger, unforgiveness, unbelief, shame, guilt. It says we lie and the truth is not in us. We do not live out the truth. Those are strong, strong words. But going on to verse 7, it says this, but if we walk in the light, open, honest, vulnerable. If we make confession a normal part of our life, we have fellowship with one another, transparency, grace, support, and love, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin.
Amen.
Many times, We can't see or recognize our own sin because we feel justified because of the pain that we suffer at the hands of others. Get this. I want you to hear this right here. But all painful wounds that are not given to Jesus are subject to the enemy's lies and ultimately result in sin. Wounds, lies, sin. Unconfessed areas in our life, the darkness in there, and that is a wound. That breeds pain in us, which is then subject to the lies of the enemy, and we run right into sin in our bad behaviors, in our unbelief, in our fear, in our guilt, in our shame, in all these things that the enemy heaps on. And many times we're blinded to it because we feel justified because of how much it hurts. I want you to understand that I understand the pain and I understand the fear that's connected to this. I understand what the enemy uses to try and keep things in the dark. But I also know the power and the freedom that comes with confession. And this is one thing that I've gotten to see. This part of triumphal trauma literally just took a whole gigantic leap into another level about a year and a half ago when we were teaching this at Teen Challenge. And there was about 40 guys there. And I just said, you know what? Guys, you may not have anyone that you've ever been able to confess to, and so I'm going to sit out on that picnic table outside, and anybody who wants to get stuff out in the open and quit letting the enemy use you as a pawn, you come out and talk to me. And I literally sat out there for over 2 hours as man after man after man just came and laid his stuff out on the table. Guys, the last year, Teen Challenge had more graduates. They have had more graduates out of the program than the last 5 years. I absolutely know for a fact that the fruit came from their willingness to confess. Because the ones that came and confessed, not only are they walking in freedom right now, many of them are working at the facility. Many of them have gone on into ministry. And so, I mean, I'm telling you, this is powerful. And if you want healing, if you want to walk out the fullness of what Jesus Christ died for, you have to implement this into your life. This has to become your modus operandi. This has to become the thing that you are allowing, or not allowing, that you are making a priority in your life. Making a priority. And let me tell you, it gets easier. Because the first time you do it, you're scared to death of all the rejection and all the possibilities of what could happen. But let me tell you, every time it gets easier. Every time it gets easier. And ultimately, this is something that we should be able to confess to one another without any fear.
Right.
We should be able to be people that are able to confess. And this is where our heart is about the church. We want the church to become trauma-informed so that they can deal with pain. Because there's a whole entire community of people that can't deal with pain. And that's not okay because this world is full of pain. And we have to be people that aren't offended by pain or that can't handle pain. That we need to be people that's like, yeah, that's a real thing, but let's deal with it. Because Jesus bore our pain.
Yeah. Amen.
I want you to hear a testimony right now of a man who allowed confession to become a part of his life in such a way, and he's now functioning as a minister in one of the largest churches in America.
The effect of holding a secret with some friends. He was a neighbor that lived across the street from me. And he told me to come over to his house. So I came over to his house and didn't go inside the house. He said, you know, come in the garage, I gotta show you something. And so I go into the garage and he just starts touching me. Just inappropriate touching. And I was 8. I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know what he was doing. But I knew it wasn't right. And I came home and I walked in the door and my mom asked me, how was my day? That was the day I became a professional liar. And I got real good at it. A couple of days later, I got called to the garage again. And again. And again. And again. I don't know how to process this. I don't know where to begin with this. I don't know how to deal with this. All I did know is that if my dad found out, he would kill him. So I had to keep it a secret. I was literally becoming two different people. And be the guy that can go to school and kind of get through a day. And then there would be the guy that cannot stop looking at pornography. This is not casual. This is, I can't stop. I'm driven to this thing. So I had to keep it a secret. I don't want to deal with these questions. I don't have answers for this. I'm 12. I'm 13, I'm 14, I'm 15, 16, 17, 18. I'm 19. And this thing is still on me. She caught me. I didn't know what to say. I was embarrassed. I felt like a pervert. I felt completely disgusted with myself. Because she's a praying woman, she went back to her room and started praying for me. It's probably the best prayer I think my mother has ever prayed. I didn't hear it. But that prayer came and got me. I got up, cleaned myself off, walked down the hallway. If I made a left, I'm gonna go to my room. I'm never gonna talk about this again. If I make a right, maybe I'd have enough strength to go in her room and tell her what the real situation was. Because it wasn't porn. That wasn't the root of the situation. My mom cried. I cried. And she went and got my younger brother. He came in my room. He said he got molested by the same guy. Then all three of us cried. My dad comes home. We share what happened. And then my mom says that she got sexually abused when she was 6. And then my dad says that he got molested when he was 5. So in one night, my exposure caused everyone to kind of come clean and confess. mean, that night, man, I just can't articulate to you the freedom I felt to be able to tell the truth to somebody and not be judged. That's the most, oh my God, you, and to have the truth come out and be surrounded by nothing but love. My parents, their relationship with Christ is amazing. They have always been authentic and real in how they live out their faith. Man, I just thank God that they weren't like the type of deep religious people that can't handle pain. I was just happy that they were, that they loved me, that they didn't judge me. We didn't grow up in an atmosphere where we saw any hypocrisy. My parents weren't one way at home and then another way at church. They were the same people. And they told us the right way, they showed us the right way. And then they just prayed for us. And you know, when the Lord got ready for us, when he called, we knew his voice because they taught us well. I would love to tell you that as soon as I accepted Christ into my life, I put porn down and never picked it up again. But the fact that the Lord would be patient enough with me, knowing that it didn't take me 5 minutes to get into it, and it probably wasn't going to take 5 minutes to get out. But if I just started walking with him, he would just start shedding layers of bondage, abuse, molestation, low self-esteem, people pleasing, and stuff. As we began to walk, stuff would just start falling off of me. And that he would give me relationships. And God really wants to love me. He loves you through people. And he brought people into my life to literally love all that crap out of me.
That's what I love. I love that.
14 years still working. It's been good. So I don't care the secrets anymore.
When you get a chance, turn the lights up again down. I know that we've talked, I've spent more time on particularly sexual sin and sexual abuse because that usually carries the most shame and the most guilt with it, but this is dealing with everybody, this is dealing with everybody's battle and every type of sin. Doesn't matter what it is, and you know, for you to carry any level of pain with you, it really is not God's first and best for you, because Jesus took that pain. So this is where we talk about taking back territory.
Yeah.
Taking back territory, because you spent a large portion of your lives in pain that are subject to the lies that have led you into sin. And until we deal with the pain, until we take back the territory that the enemy used to occupy. And here's how we do that. Romans 12:11 says, "For the accuser of the brothers and sisters," who's that? Us. Everybody say us.
Us.
Okay. "Accuses them before God day and night." But here's the good news. He has been hurled down.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Jesus conquered the accuser. It goes on to say, "And they triumphed over him." Say triumphed.
Triumph.
That's what this workshop is all about.
That's
you triumphing. Right. "They triumphed over him," the devil, "by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony." Everybody say, "My testimony."
My testimony.
Triumphs over the devil.
Triumphs over the devil.
1 John 1:9 says, "If we say we have no sin, we've deceived ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from from all unrighteousness. In the room of grace, sin has no such power. I am Christ in me on my worst day, in my worst thought, during my worst temptation. Here's where the power to confess is, guys. When you view yourself through the eyes of grace, through the eyes of Christ, God's not dealing with your sin anymore. It's already been dealt with. Amen. It's already been paid for. God is not worried about your sin. He's worried about your relationship. He wants you to know about your identity because He's already paid for the sin. He's dealt with the sin. Now He wants you to act like who you are. And so He's more concerned about you acting like who you are than about the things that you might still be struggling with.
Right.
Because if you would take your eyes off of and give your pain to Jesus and take your eyes off of all the things that are broken and put them on Christ and what Christ has accomplished for you, you will begin to act like who you are.
Amen.
The walking that Tim was talking, Pastor Tim, the testimony that you just heard, the walking that he walked out, walking with him, that's walking by the Spirit, guys.
Yeah.
He said that the stuff just sheds off of you. All that crap, all the garbage, all the pain, all the abuse, all the abandonment, all the frustration, all the habitual sin, everything that we've been walking in and subject to with the shame and the guilt and fear, it sheds off of us because we begin stepping into who we are in Jesus Christ.
Yes. That's exactly right.
So let's say this together. I am Christ in me.
I am Christ in me.
On my worst day.
On my worst day.
In my worst thought.
In my worst thought.
And during my worst temptation.
And during my worst temptation.
Wow. So this is a quote from a book called The Cure, and it talks about confession in there a lot. This says, so I learned to tell on myself, both to God and others. That sounds like confession. Learning to tell on ourselves. Now, I know that if you have been around and in the criminal activity or have grown up, secrets are a normal part of that lifestyle. In fact, if you don't carry the secret, you're considered a snitch. And in some circles, that's death. And they'll kill a snitch. And so this is something that the enemy has used as a stronghold to keep people absolutely entrapped and literally carrying the weight of other people's
that
sins.
That is so true.
Carrying the weight of other people's sins.
Wow.
Because you're agreeing to stay and not divulging the truth, okay? So what I'm saying is, it's not just that you're not gonna say, it's that you have information that is hurting someone else or can hurt someone else, and you're not bringing it into the light. Okay, that's the same thing. And so we need to learn to tear down and say, I'm not going to be a person who will harbor the darkness for the enemy. I'm not going to be someone more afraid of man than I am afraid of God.
Right.
God says, fear me only. That's it.
Yeah,
right. So I know that has been a real thing in your life. If you've been in the criminal community at all, that snitching, that's been a huge no-no, and it was something. But let me tell you, the freedom that comes and the confidence that comes with in God, in Jesus, when you're willing to bring things into the light, the minute that you have. I'm not just talking. So if someone says, hey man, can you carry a secret for me? You just straight up tell, no, I can't. I say everything. I'm just a gigantic confession bubble. And so I don't tell me anything that you don't want confessed, because that's what I do. I confess. And the reality of it is that we need to become people that are safe to confess to. And as far as we can handle that, but we don't need people there. We point them to Jesus. Are you hearing me? Okay. So we learn to tell on ourselves. This is something Dad and I did. When we were running a construction crew in the company, there were two crews, in the 90s, and most of our guys were recovering addicts or still addicts. And it was one thing that we didn't care if you were not sitting at the bar with a bottle in your hand. Call. Learn to tell on yourself. There was one of the most powerful men's ministries I've ever experienced. We had about 40 to 50 guys that would meet once a week, and there was levels of accountability that if any one man was struggling, there was five or six to stand next to him. And I'm telling you, it was one of the most healthy things I'd seen, and I got to grow up in that and see that and experience it myself. So once we understand how God sees us and who we are to him, that's identity, we can then learn to confess the sin that we intend to commit rather than confess the sin that we've already carried out.
Yeah.
Learn to confess the sin that you intend to commit. How many of you know when you're vulnerable?
Yeah.
Come on. How many of you know? You know when you're feeling down. You know when things are getting hard. You know it. You feel the pressure. You feel the worry. You feel the anxiety. You feel the fear. You feel all those things. That's your trigger point to reach out.
Yes.
Feel the anger.
Yeah. That is the point in which you reach out. Because then you can just confess. You can confess, listen, I'm struggling. I feel like I'm going to go back and use. I feel like I'm going to go back and, you know, look at pornography. I feel like I'm going to go back and drink. I feel like I'm going to go back and, you know, I'm going to go blow up on this person and tell them how it is. You know, all these different things that we intend to commit because of how we're feeling. If we can reach out and have a safe place where we can have someone where we call and say, listen, I don't want to do this anymore. I want to stop this cycle right now, and I need someone to stand with me and help me. Will you pray with me right now? Will you help me walk by the Spirit? Tell someone in the first moment that you recognize you're vulnerable to sin. Now, guys, there's this little nasty thing called pride that gets in the way of that. We think that we can do it on our own. We cannot. The flesh cannot overcome. This is a work of the Spirit. And I want to just really challenge you and really encourage you that these steps, confession can be one of the most powerful and beneficial things in your next journey with Jesus. Because it will literally take you into freedom and healing that has yet been discovered in your life. So we're going to take about a 10-minute break. So go ahead and get something to drink, use the restroom, and we're going to come back.
There are brownies and cookies and fruit and vegetables.